Then while executing your research, you get good set of data. The data should be reproducible, reliable, and dependable. Reproducibility is absolutely essential. So if you have done a good set of experiments and then a particular set of data has been obtained, then if you have done them exactly the way they are supposed to be done, then you can reproduce those results. And if there are more assumptions, more things that are changing within your experiments day to day, then the data would not be reproducible. So it is essential that the data that you generate is reproducible, reliable, dependable. And then you have sufficient sets of data generated to meet the statistical requirement. You cannot base conclusions on sample sizes which are lower than what statistics define. If insufficient data is available, suppose due to certain factors, there's only a particular set of data is available, not as much as you want, you can draw conclusions based on that. You can only claim trend. You cannot say that I have done the experiment in duplicate, but it is statistically significant. You cannot make that statement, you know. If n is equal to 6 minimum that is necessary, you had only a triplicate data, then you must say that we failed to secure adequate data to apply statistical tests, but the data obtained in triplicate has given us a confidence that the trend is in the direction. So we have to reproduce this particular data. So the conclusion is inconclusive. It is, you know, the conclusion can be used only if you have provide more data to support this trend. That should be there. Data analysis must be very appropriate. You should draw right conclusions. You cannot draw wrong conclusions. You should not draw superfluous conclusions. One standard conclusion I will tell you as an example. A plant extract is evaluated for an anti-inflammatory activity. And the data clearly show that the plant extract is active as a standard compound at a particular dose. And so your conclusion is that the plant extract does possess anti-inflammatory activity comparable to that of the standard aspirin or indomethacin or, you know, pyraxicam, whatever, you know. But then there is another conclusion you normally see in the literature is that the plant extract is reported to contain, remember that word, bioflavonoids, polyphenolic compounds, which has antioxidant potential. Therefore, the anti-inflammatory activity is due to the presence of these bioflavonoids. That conclusion cannot be drawn because your data has not shown that the bioflavonoid fraction from the plant extract is responsible for the activity. You can only conclude that if you further fractionate the extract and take an extract rich of bioflavonoid component, which started demonstrating higher activity than the original plant extract or activity at a lower dose, then you can draw possibly because of bioflavonoids, because the bioflavonoid rich component showed activity. So that type of data has to be there in order to draw that conclusion. So therefore, it is very essential how you compile your data, how you analyze it, and how you report it. You cannot make conclusions from the data more than what the data is actually stating. You know, it's very important. Please remember that. Once your data is all ready, once you have analyzed the data, tabulated it, and then analyzed it, and then presented it in the form of figures or tables, and drawn your conclusions, it is the time to present your results and discussion, your research results and discussion. So that means you are ready to make your final research presentation, where you will go back to the research committee and say that 6 months ago or 1 year ago, I have made a research proposal presentation, and now I am coming with results and discussion. So therefore, here is the presentation which indicates that, to tell you that these are the results obtained. So therefore, I have achieved or not achieved my research objective. Here again, this is in a seminar format. It must define your objective and the target product profile from your research proposal. what you are saying, there your research objective is that, and that is the target product profile that you have mentioned, and you have to recall that, saying that our research objective was to define or to derive a particular or to develop a particular dosage form, and the dosage form must have these capabilities. So we set out to achieve that purpose and we performed this methodology. And these are the various experiments performed and these are the results that have been obtained. And these results clearly indicate that a target product profile molecule, drug product or formulation must demonstrate these capabilities, and our results clearly indicate that the products that we have developed, the prototype formulations that we have developed in our experiments have, in our research, has clearly shown these results, indicating that it behaves exactly the way we expected it to behave to give rise to the target product profile that we expect to have. So the experimental data obtained indicates that we are progressing in the right direction. What more to be done? Since all the in vitro tests, the release profile, everything is perfect. Now we have to do in vivo to look at bioavailability. And then we have performed that data also. And here is the bioavailability data. And the bioavailability data clearly indicate, compare it to the standard conventional dosage form, that it is achieving the type of concentrations and duration of action as delineated in the target product profile. So therefore, by this approach, by doing this, we have developed a dosage form to meet our research objective. This is how you present, and that completes the research proposal, the research execution, and the research conclusion, results and discussion seminar, that the committee can tell you, now go ahead and write your thesis. But before that, you publish your papers. So it is very essential at this particular point, you are ready to communicate, and through a scientific communication. So at this particular point, you would make either an oral communication, which you have already done, if you had to remember that. You made an oral seminar presentation to your research committee, to your class, So that is the beginning. That's where you develop the capability, Now, as a scientist, you must be now presenting this data in a oral communication, present it in a research, in a conference, as a oral presentation or a poster presentation. But even poster presentation, you have to stand next to the poster and explain. In oral presentation, there is no poster, you have slides, and then you talk for 15 minutes about your research to an audience sitting there. In a poster presentation, you stand next to a poster for 2 or 3 hours, and there are so many people who are coming by and stop by your poster. You have to explain the salient features and answer any questions. Then you write them as research papers for publication into journals. How a scientific publication can be written, what are the norms of making good scientific writing, is another lecture. So probably I would be coming back to give that talk also. The research paper can either be a full-fledged research paper, depending upon the quantum of the work that you have achieved, the quantum of the data and how it can be presented, or it can be a very short or rapid publication. And this publication, either as a oral publication or a poster publication, poster presentation or a scientific paper, is very essential to establish yourself as a scientist. Because when people see your paper published, then only they'll regard that you are a scientist. So therefore, publication, then you have to write up this work in the form of a research thesis to defend the thesis to obtain your master's or PhD degree. So scientific and written communications are very essential. Now, at this particular point, I'll just only talk a little bit about how do you make an abstract based on your research project. From the beginning, when you start designing your research, the literature search, and the research objective, and the rationale, what is responsible, what that the literature lacked, or how the literature supported, given a justification for your research, and what you set out to achieve in your research, what is your objective, and what kind of a methodology that you have established, that you have not established, methodology that you have employed to obtain the results, and those results upon analysis has given you indication, enough evidence to demonstrate that your research objective has been attained. These words that whatever I have spoken to should be written up in the form of an abstract. You don't write too much introduction. You write only one sentence introduction, establishing the need for your research. That would justify why you have taken up the project. Then write your objective. The objective is to develop a dosage form or to evaluate a plant extract or to find useful activity, whatever is that. And then what methodology did you use to perform experiments that gave you the data, and analysis of that data has indicated that you have attained your objective. That means your objective or your aim has been fulfilled. That has to be written. In neat, one or two sentences for methods, one or two sentences for results, one or two sentences for the conclusions and final bottom line. All that should be. If necessary, give one or two references. Because in some abstracts, references are necessary, particularly if you are presenting it for an oral or poster presentation. But if it is an abstract that you are sending for certain other purposes, then it's not necessary. Then you also provide a set of keywords. The abstract can also become a part of your research paper, because each research publication will have an abstract. So the abstract serves as a purpose of the beginning of a research paper, or you send it to a conference for acceptance as an oral or poster presentation, or you can send it to any other agency to draw attention to your research. And the keywords, the choice of keywords is very essential, because most of the databases only show abstracts. And these abstracts are, in data mining, they are drawn or they are recognized based on the strength of the keywords. Because nobody will remember your name or the title of your paper. Somebody who is searching for what work has been done in the development of a particular dosage form for a particular drug, then they would put two or three type keywords. And those keywords should pick up your abstract, such that person somewhere sitting, in North America or in South Africa will be able to understand that you have done this work, which is presented in a conference or published in a research paper. In a journal. This is very essential. So that is the power of the abstract. The abstract would actually capture, it's like an executive summary, capture the essence of your research, and it should have the keywords to be able to track that, extract it out of databases using search engines. I'm sure at the end of this talk, you have gained sufficient knowledge in order to understand what are the attributes and fundamentals necessary for good research, and how to define your research, how to make a research project proposal, and how to execute research, and how to analyze the data, and how to make a presentation based on how you analyze the data and draw conclusions to explain to people that your research objective has been fulfilled, and then write an abstract to send it for a publication or a poster or oral presentation. Thank you very much.